we work on complex systems, and well, we do some complex things for the modeling, and I'm going to show you a very easy one that's graphical and not sophisticated. A long time ago, four years ago, we started working with data, and we decided to retrieve together some bits, some with some millions. We are still gathering it, and as far as we had this data, we had to do something with it. The first thing you do with the data is plot it, and when we're plotting without this, for example, you see Turkey. Well, don't look at this, I don't know what's that. And here you can see road, railway. What's that? Who's living there? Nobody. So strange. And from that picture, I drew a paper called Tweets on the Roads. We don't know if people tweet when driving, but we know that there are a lot of tweets located just some meters far away from the road. So when we drive, or when we are in the car and someone on the drives, we use to tweet. So let's start. We have that plot, we have the data. At that moment, we were using 2 years of data. In Euro, we had 5 million of geodetic tweets. Now we were out of 70 million global geodetic tweets. And now we are not repeating, but improving the study with 200 million tweets. And it's getting better, of course. So we have the tweets, we have a rail shape file for the railways and the roads. This one is for railways, and we have some tools. We did the start working on it. What did go wrong? Nothing. But maybe it wasn't that easy. We are not computer scientists, most of us are physicists and mathematician, and we are not from the technical field. So we started looking for tweets near the railways, and the first thing you see is you have to get this one in the shapefile. You have the align string defining the railway, the road line, and we decided to we were focusing on the tweet just 20 meters far from that one. But yeah, you say that, it seems trivial, but you know you have latitude, longitude, and 1 degree here is not 1 degree, it's not the same meters that you have higher or lower latitudes, so what's the need? Trivial. We had to do something. Most of the projections are using latitudes and longitude, but some of them use UTM meters. So we have to get back to our tweets with latitude, longitude, and Mercator projection to one of the meters of the UTMs, and then we get back to latitude, longitude. The problem with that is, well, you know, when you define the focus where you project, it's different if you are in the States or in Europe. If you get a center, it's a point located here, you have a lot of detail. The distance will be good enough, but here too far. So you have to use very specific projections in every region. I think in Europe we were using, I don't remember this, but 10, 12 projections. So we defined it was easy, depending on the latitude and longitude to Europe. We were using one or the other. So we just got that. That could be done with QGIS, but we don't want to use it. We use graphical interfaces or that, and we were doing all the work with Python and R, so we got it done in Python. We just get the first projection. We project the line to the meters, projection, and sorry, here. We project to the meters, then buffer the line 20 meters, that's our space of work, and we transform back to latitudes and longitudes to deal with our tweets. So we have small links for the shape up, for the railways and the roads, it's the same thing. And we just had to compare if our tweets were located in that buffer we defined. So we just have to do that. But if you start doing it, you did it. It happens to, it's not possible, you don't get it in your life. So we had to improve it. It wasn't difficult, of course. It was something quite stupid. We have countries. The first approach was to reduce and instead of checking each tweet to all the J file or the European J file, we just concentrated in countries, and then the speed up wasn't enough, and then we reduced to level. So we get the shapefile of the countries, we get the rounding words of each country, we could do that in another level, and then just check that the tweet is located in the country rounding words. We were using pandas for that, and it was quick enough. So we had it. Let's start doing things. So now we have the tweets near the roads. First thing we have to do is to know if you have a lot of kilometers of roads, railways, how's your system? Because different systems will produce different results. So for example, here's Turkey. They have a lot of highways, but very few railways. Then there's, I think this one is Germany, that's all of everything is Germany. In Spain, I'm not sure where is Spain here, the ratio is we have much more roads, highways, than railways. Okay, we have some basic information, but we need to know if our Twitter data is good. What's the penetration rate? Is that data valid for our analysis, or is to be asked and it's not good, and the conclusions we can get from that are not basic or are not applicable to different places. Can we trust them? We noticed that I was showing you Turkey because it's a special case in the study. We didn't think at the beginning that Turkey was going to be that strange. But you see, in the west part, the penetration rate, meaning number of users with geolocated tweets divided by the population, by inhabitants, in the west is good. In the east, we don't know why, it's not that good. Seems that, for example, in Germany, they don't tweet, or they don't tweet with geolocalized data. We think that it's just they don't use geolocated data. But we don't know that. to get that differences, to get information on that differences, we started thinking of the GDP. Depending if you have a rich country or a poor country, maybe you have differences. In fact, there's a study, there's a paper assessing that that's true. In richer countries, Twitter is most used, and in poor countries, they don't use it. But in Europe, we get that cloud, and for us, that's not. The correlation is not good, it's too spread. So for us in Europe, there's no relation between GDP and penetration rate, the use of Twitter. Of course, in worldwide level, when you get very poor countries, I mean, countries in Africa compared to developed and very rich countries, of course, it's true, in Africa it's difficult to tweet or to have access to basic things, so you don't tweet, and in other places it's easier. But I think it's just a matter of place you get information from. Then we got information on the social network. We find it by relations between users when you reply to someone, and we discovered when we plot, that's the probability distribution of the number of relations, and we got a nice power law. That's what it's not usual. A power law is a formula that's x to the k, and then we got the exponent of that, and the exponent was for most of the countries very, very similar. So the way we do it, the way we adapt to that technology is similar across Europe. In this plot, we have 5 countries. They were got randomly from all the 39, but basically all the countries have the same OB and the same law. One of the examples of this same law is, for me it was strange to read it like that. The frequencies between clicks when you surf the web, if you are a human, you get a power law. That's why we cannot reproduce human behavior with computers and robots. Then we have the tweets, we have the railways, we got all the information, we just plot and get the coverage, his railway, sorry, roads and railways. As you see in Spain, the coverage is almost 100%. What about Turkey? Turkey in roads. Very, very good, but not that good in railways. We know that they don't have railways, and we expect them to be too expensive. We haven't get into that yet. Then we look at the penetration rate. Sorry, that's enough here. We compare the penetration rate, the Twitter penetration rate, with the highway coverage and the railway coverage, and we see a clear relation within all the countries. Perfect, that's good. And finally, we get a number, the proportion of bits in transfers. One thing that's strange, we have no explanation yet for that, is that you see Germany, they had very few tweets, very few geolocated tweets, but the proportion of geolocated tweets in railways or roads is amazing. It's the best of all of them. So something's going on there. Maybe they're just using geolocated tweets to to say something like, I don't know, I'm bored, or I'm not on time, or to complain to the companies, but I think it's more a Spanish way of doing things, not Northern Europe. This is the percentage of tweets we had in grays and rows. You see Turkey, we had a lot of tweets in rows, not that much in grays. This is an example of Turkey, I mentioned it there. And when we concluded that such experiment, we went one step farther and we tried to see if Twitter was good enough to help us predict the number, the demand, or the frequency of the railways in Europe. Why not? There's no much data in Europe on that. There's a lot of people working on this. Countries are expecting someone to do it, and companies are reluctant to give information. In Europe, we have a lot of companies related to railways, but you see, this, for example, is the line, are the lines of Thales, and they cross different countries, from Amsterdam, Brussels, Paris. Here you have four countries, and if is in some cases someone gives you information, gives it by country level. So that is, it's not covered. You don't get information on that, and companies don't want to play the game with other ones, and they don't want to say I'm not the most used railway company in Europe, so you have no information basically. This is the railway map in Europe, not complete. For example, in Portugal,
high speed.
It's just high speed. Here in Portugal should be a new one, but basically it's 5-10 years ago, this map. And sometimes we are lucky and have some statistics. For example, unbelievably, Renfe gives us some data. Some, I mean, not all the data. We have a nice map of the routes. And yes, well, it's a map. We cannot get information on that. Then we have a nice map that I had to get bigger, and that's super pixel because it's very tiny. With the railway demand, you just know the number of passengers per branch wants to go from Madrid to Barcelona, for example, per year. So not a lot of information. You don't have monthly data. You don't have regular no information. Even more, these ones, you don't know if they go through Zaragoza or through Valencia, for example. You just know that the starting point is Madrid and the end point is Barcelona. Maybe it could be good to know which of the branches are they taking. They are supposed to get the optimal one, but we don't know it. More things, we have frequencies. Yes, they have map, and they have the frequencies on the web. We scrap them, of course, from the map you cannot get anything. And we plotted it. We just have these tweets. We focused in Spain, because we had to start with one of the countries. Started here. And that was a go with all the railways. But we focused on other. As you see, yes, we have information. No information here. and very few information in some lines. From that, we thought we could not get that much. But well, we were trying. Don't worry, just one small formula. That's not a formula, not a real equation. We find the coefficient of railway usage. It's the travel time times the average frequency, as much trains there are, it's going to be more used. This line is going to be more used. And the train capacity, depending on the number of seats you have, it's going to be used or not. Basically, we can use that because the number of seats is constant. More or less. Because if it changes a lot, we cannot use that to infer anything. The one of the travel time is because it's well known that it's well known. There are some papers on that that say that as you would think, for short distances, we use different transport as for long distances. I mean, if you have to travel from Almeria to Paris, you're probably not going through by train or by bus. You're going to get a plane. So depending on the distance, but if you go to Granada, you're not going to get a plane, of course. So depending on the distance, on the time you spend traveling, you get one or the other transport. We continued our study by crossing information between the usage and disease, way more than one, the number of tweets in the rail. As you see here, this is 40,000, 60,000, and so on. For most of the lines, we had no data, it wasn't enough. And for these three branches, it seemed to be better. When compared to passengers here, these four, in fact, are the same here. Why these three are that separated from the others? These three are these branches, Madrid, Córdoba, Madrid, Zaragoza, Zaragoza, Barcelona. Why are that different? Because they are overlapping branches. When you go to Barcelona, maybe you are going north, or when you go to Zaragoza, maybe you are going to Huesca or to Barcelona. So there are overlapping data, less overlapping data here, so we don't expect to have good information in that. So we have a problem. It seems it's not going to work what we were planning to do. Then we compared number of Twitter users with passengers per year. That was the only information that Renfe gave us. And we supposed that the that were not Twitter users, that were railway users that used Twitter, that tweeted almost once in their trajectory, in their route, in their trip. The same differences. These few ones are good, but not the others. So we can just explain things here. All the other ones, not good. We have the same problem. It's not good, we don't have information. So we are looking for new data or estimations, and we noticed that in Italy, not all the data is public, but for these lines, that they have a frequency of 15 minutes is good data. So we just started working on that with some preliminary information. It seems it's gonna work, but who knows? Not. We haven't spent enough time on that. Europe is a nightmare. We don't have any open data policy. We cannot do basically anything here. Nor at the country level and European level, neither. So, what about the states? There, the policies are quite different. And even that they don't use railways as much as expected, they have a very good network and one big company. Maybe that big company has information. You see, you have, for example, one route can be, I'm guessing it's San Francisco to Miami, I don't know. But one route crosses all the states. In the same way as in Europe, you cross a lot of, here you cross a lot of states, in Europe you cross a lot of countries, but here the policies are the same for all the countries, so maybe here we get some information. We have the frequencies, nice map, no, we scrap the data. Here we cannot get anything, but you see here, this line, do you think there's a lot of people living there? I mean, there's people living there, but not near the railway, so we have some data, and there's just one train per day. Even that, in this one, there are just three trains per week, and we got information. So, not as much as we expected, but there's some information. So now we are working on that. We are basically focusing on Italy and the States. Maybe if we get some information from the States, we'll talk to European people, and maybe we'll try to get more information, but through a high level demand, because it's working on a country level, it's my nightmare. It's impossible to get nothing, to get anything. So we are basically estimating the occupancy, not the usage. More or less, it's the same. We are working on the validation of the data. Even now, we are trying to get raw information from the companies. If we get information from one company, if we could get information real good, if the data from Renfe, for example, we could validate our conclusions. And if you know the number of carriages, the rolling stock you have for each line, it's easier to get it. But for now, no good results, and we're still working on that. And that's it.
You're sending latitude and longitude every time you do it. So
people is not that busy that tweets, and usually when they do, they have the connection.
Well, I see that your research is a work in progress. Can we follow the progress you're making in some place?
No, now, but we are supposed to publish all the code in Java. Thank you.